I took the supermarket flowers from the windowsill. I threw the day-old tea from the cup. Pack out the photo album Mama had made. Memories of a life that's been loved. Took the cat wells, stone cards and soft animals. Put the old ginger beer down the sink. Friends always told me, don't you cry when you're down. But there's a tear every time that I blink. Oh, I'm in pieces, it's tearing me up. But I know a heart that's broke is a heart that's been loved. So I sing hallelujah. Shape of my dad. When I fell down, you'll be there holding me up. Stretch your wings as you go, and when God takes you back, he say hallelujah, you're home. I fluffed the pillows, made the beds, talked the chairs up. Folded your night suits neatly in a case. Mom says she'd drive and put her hand on my cheek. Wipe a tear from the side of my face. I hope that I see the world that you did. Cause I know a life with love is a life that's been lived. So I sing hallelujah. Shape of my dad. When I fell down, you'll be there holding me up. Stretch your wings as you go, and when God takes you back, he said hallelujah, you're home. Oh, shape of my dad. You gotta see the person that I've become. Spread your wings, and I know that when God took you back, he said hallelujah, you're home. I took the supermarket flowers from the windowsill. I threw the day-old tea from the cup. Pack out the photo album Mama had made. Memories of a life that's been loved. Took the cat wells, stone cards and soft animals. Put the old ginger beer down the sink. Friends always told me, don't you cry when you're down. But there's a tear every time that I blink. Oh, I'm in pieces, it's tearing me up. But I know a heart that's that's broke is a heart that's been loved. So I sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my dad. When I fell down, you'll be there holding me up. Stretch your wings as you go. And when God takes you back, he say hallelujah. Fluff the pillows, make the beds, talk to chairs. Fold out your night suits neatly in a case. Mom says she'd drive and put her hand on my cheek. Wipe a tear from the side of my face. I hope that I see the world that you did. Cause I know a life with love is a life that's been lived. So I sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my dad. When I fell down, you'll be there holding me up. Stretch your wings as you go. And when God takes you back, he said supermarket flowers from the windowsill. I threw the day-old tea from the cup. Pack out the photo album Mama had made. Memories of a life that's been loved. Took the cat wells, stone cards and soft animals. Put the old ginger beer down the sink. Friends always told me, don't you cry when you're down. But there's a tear every time that I blink. Oh, I'm in pieces, it's tearing me up. But I know a heart that's broke is a heart that's been loved. So I sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my dad. Stretch your wings as you go. And when God takes you back, he say hallelujah, you're home. Fluff the pillows, make the beds, talk to chairs. Fold out your night suits neatly in a case. Says she'd drive and put her hand on my cheek. Wipe a tear from the side of my face. I hope that I see the world that you did. Cause I know a life with love life is a life that's been lived. So I sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my dad. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Spread your wings as you go. And when God takes you back, he said, hallelujah, you're home. See the person that I've become. Spread your wings, and I know that when God took you back, he said, hallelujah, you're home. I took the supermarket flowers from the windowsill. I threw the day-old tea from the cup. Pack out the photo album Mama had made. Memories of a life that's been loved. Took the cat wells, stone cards, and soft animals. Put the old ginger beer down the sink. Friends always told me, don't you cry when you're down. But there's a tear every time that I blink. Oh, I'm in pieces, it's tearing me up. But I know my heart that's broken is a heart that's been loved. So I sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my dad. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Stretch your wings as you go. And when God takes you back, he say hallelujah. Fluffed the pillows, made the beds, talked the chairs up. Folded your night suits neatly in a case. Mom says she'd drive and put her hand on my cheek and wipe a tear.
And
chest. Let your night suits neatly in a case. Moon says she drive and put her hand on my cheek. Wipe a tear from the side of my face. I walk down to see the world as she did. Cause I know a life with love is a life that's been lived. So I stand and we are. You were an angel in the shape of my dad. When I fell down, you'd be there pulling me up. Spread your wings as you were.
Testimony that you run the race. And we understand sometimes the race could be difficult. The race would take a lot of commitment. The race will take a lot of sacrifice. But at the end, you run the race till you see His face. And Lord, this is our testimony. Let me live in the glory of Your grace. We have another song coming up, The Goodness of God.
Sing of the goodness of God.
Testimony. Even though you go through the fire, even though you go through stuff, even though the nights are dark, you know the goodness of God. Our brother knew of the goodness of the God that he served, and I'm told he was quite prepared to leave us here and go and meet him. What a testimony! What a testimony! You may have your seats. We have the scripture reading coming up. I think some people have been prepared to do that, so we ask you to come down.
The Gospel according to John chapter 11, 25 to 26. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? John chapter 14, 1-4. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. That where I am, there ye may be also. And whether I go, ye go. Ye know, and the way ye know.
Thank you very much. Confirmation in the scripture. The Lord didn't just leave us here without an exact description of where we would be and what he has prepared for us. Very, very good. Confirmation in the scripture. We move to the eulogy. Anela, are you reading the eulogy? Who's doing the eulogy?
Gardens. When he became a horticulturist, he had a passion for orchids. He used to cultivate them home on his job. I remember my dad taking me to work with him, where he taught me gardening skills and love for flowers and plants. My dad was a florist by profession, and he loved his work. I remember him taking me to his job to show me things about orchid plants, lawn, and different stuff that is in a nice little garden. It was quite an experience, you know. And today I just look back on those days and those times we had together. And it seems to me like this is not happening and it cannot penetrate my skull to realize that this is happening. I still can't get it, you know. So he had demonstrated to me as a loving father for all his children, and he was independent person. He liked to do things for himself. He might take a help from you, but generally speaking, he wanted to do things himself. My dad birthday, 94th birthday, recently passed. On his birthday, recently passed his birthday, and mommy made a cake, and she asked him to blow it and make a wish. He said, 94 and no more. Like, he realized that, you know, with his age and the way he feel, what he was going through, you know, he said, no more. And he got his wish, he got his wish. And I was privileged when I heard mommy tell me that daddy's kind of low in his situation and health wise. I said, mommy, I'm coming. I can't tell you exactly when, but I'm coming very soon. And I was privileged to bless my eyes on my dad and my mom. And while I was coming in that plane, I said, Lord, all I want is to give me my wish to bless my eyes on my mother and my father. And I did bless my eyes on them. And I give God thanks. And I give God thanks for answering for what I left New York for. What is so good, you know, about him is that he knew what was happening and he knew where he was going. And it's so comforting for him and for us to know that after this physical earth, where will you be? And he understands, and he surrendered all. So I'm happy to know that, you know, he is in the hands of the Lord, and without a shadow of a doubt, he is in a better place. I love you, Daddy, for everything you taught me. Things you taught me, I will always know it. With clamps and cutting lawn and fixing pots, fixing bed, putting manure, waking up the grass. You know, he showed me once and I happened to get to like it. So I was enjoying the time we spent together at his job. And something I will never forget. Daddy, I love you. Thank you for everything you have taught me. And I know one day I will meet you again. Thank you.
Pastor Banfield, elders, everyone here this morning, good morning. Thank you all for being present to honor and celebrate my dad's life. I am grateful to return to Trinidad a few days ago and met my dad alive. Unfortunately, that was a short-lived reality. And today is indeed a tough day for my family. My dad was a popular person in his village where he grew up. He managed to outlive all his friends and peers and made it to 94. Daddy, I wish I can do that. Well done, Daddy. My dad left us with many memories that will carry us for a lifetime with a smile in our faces. The simple one or two word sentences, and we knew exactly what he meant. Like about. He would just say one word, about, and it means I don't understand. He will also say, skid out, when he wants us to hurry up. Skid out. And that's just to name a few. I could go on and on. We had our own language. I left my parents' home to pursue a life in America when my dad was 60 years old. And so I can recall most of his younger days. What I distinctly recall was that he was a guy that hung out a lot with friends. And there was a word that he uses often. The word is undone. I don't know if that's a word. I really don't know if that's a word. He makes his own vocabulary. He used to say that he will never see his family undone, meaning without what the family needs. So he made sure of that before hanging out. Despite my migration, my dad and I maintained a closeness like no other. He would visit me in New York, not frequently, but memorably. I remember taking him to a buffet. Poor dad. He did not know that the waitress changes the dishes frequently. So my dad was fighting the waiter to keep his plate. He was doing like this. Good times. Priceless. The memories that we hold. For my dad. Upon returning to Trinidad a few days ago, I was not surprised, but sorry that my dad's health deteriorated rapidly, hence this outcome. But what I did for my dad in these last few days, I really thought I couldn't do for anyone. But I did it without hesitation. But that said, it is quite evident that when you love someone, nothing is too much to do to comfort them. Daddy, I love you, and I will miss you. My dad had a special love for my mom. So special that whatever she says, he will abide willingly and humbly. My dad was so impartial, and he was a problem solver. The one thing that will forever resonate with me is that my father trusted my opinion on many decisions. Daddy, you have been a great father, protector, provider. Great job, Daddy. May God bless your soul and rest in peace. His memories will carry on for a lifetime. I cherish the memories that I created with my father, and I have the assurance that he is smiling down on all of us today. Thank you very much. Thank you again for coming out, everyone.
I would like to say a few things about my dad when I was growing up with him. My dad was a good guy, good man, and he teach me a lot of stuff, especially landscaping. He was like a doctor for plants. He just know how to treat a plant. Whatever they did, he didn't know when to cut it. Was the right time. So I learned a lot of stuff from him. And he teach me as a little boy growing up, you know. He teach me many, many things, but I wouldn't get into all those things. So, you know, and he teach me a lot of stuff, you know, from a little boy, become a teenager, become a big man, he still teach me with plenty of stuff. Two things I remember very well that he teach me. At any time you're in fall, he tell me go for a cutlash and a bag. That was in the 70s. And he said, where are you going? He said, go and catch crab. And he will carry me in Westmoreland there. Right now we have plenty of houses there. But in the mango, and he will lie down in his belly and push his hand in a hole. I want to know something wrong with him. He will pull out crab from a hole. And he teach me how to catch crab in a hole. And he say, I used to say, but it's only mud you pull up. When I do so, tap up inside the mud. So he teach me how to catch crab. He also teach me how to throw a line to fishing. He never give me a fish, but he show me how to catch a fish. He show me how to catch a crab. So there is a few things, but it's many more I could say how my father teach me, you know? And may God rest his soul and he in a good place, and I love my dad, and daddy, I love you. Thank you.
My granddad was like a father figure to me. He taught me everything outdoors, like cutting the lawn, planting pepper trees. I will never forget him. I love you.
The inevitable, yet very harsh, reality of death has entered the doors of Chatarpaul Ganness. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for being here. My daddy, you have fought a good fight. You have finished the race. You have kept the faith, daddy. You sure did. It is a new day. A new leaf has turned. A new chapter has begun. Life will never be the same again in the Ganness family. Chatar, Chats, Dada, Uncle Dada, brother-in-law, Dad, Granddad, Daddy, were the titles by which he was known. First of all, I thank God Almighty for blessing my father with 84. Do the math. 84, not 70. Thank God. My father was the eldest child in his family. He had very humble beginnings, endured hardships while growing up, which have molded him to be the man that he was. And yesterday I was talking to Auntie Puna, and she told me that they were so poor that when relatives came or whatever, he had sugar water to drink and he was hiding it behind his back. He didn't want them to see what he was drinking. My father was not academic, but was educated in skills needed for life, like you would hear Cayman said and Norman. My father and mother were married for 64 years. What a blessing. Together, they had 5 children. No, wait, I left out a part. He got married to Dolly Bisessa at the age of 29. Together, they had 5 children. My father and mother were married for 64 years. They both genuinely loved each other. My father loved all his children and grandchildren equally, and all his relatives. He assured us this from time and time again. He was from one extreme to the next, from a taxi driver to a highly recognized, well-respected worker at the president's house at the time of Sir Ellis Clark. As children, my 4 brothers and I looked forward to attend Christmas parties at the president's house, where my father was well attired in uniform to serve the president's guests. He worked 3 jobs to guarantee that his family was well taken care of. My father was also a professional golfer who played tournaments in various countries and won trophies, cups, and medals. My father taught me how to swing a golf club. He liked cars. He always involved in a conversation about cars. But first, he rode a bicycle. And every evening, my siblings and I, we used to stand up by the gate waiting for when he would come with the bicycle. He then had a Hillman. And then he had a Viva. That Viva gave him fever, always breaking down. From then on, he advanced to better cars. He loved cars. And I bought that Kia because of my father. It was a brand new car, and it was the first time my father experienced a brand new car in his life. My father also had some popular sayings. If so be the case, meaning, well, if that is so. If he didn't understand the reason for something, he would say, about. Ivan said that, and stress on the about. One day he said, me, I will not die. I will live until I die. He really lived until he died. He lived off for life. He also enjoyed food, a good curry with pepper and surwa. Do you know what a surwa? Yeah, long gravy in the curry. A good stew pork, doubles, provision. Linda's hot bread at Christmas time with ham. And coconut water. Sweet things. He had a sweet tooth. Ice cream, cake, pay me. Roshni used to make pay me for him. This is for you, Roshni. And everything sweet. He just loved food. Anything tasting good, and mommy would make sure she cooked everything that he likes and how he likes it. That's what they enjoyed together, cooking and eating. We loved to eat. Now, for the not so pleasant things, you know, nobody is perfect. Nobody is perfect. My father in his younger days limed a lot with his friends. He was a smoker as well. However, my father outlived all his peers. And I am sure those peers have their relatives here right now. Despite his liming and drinking, my father always made sure that the family was well taken care of financially. Undone. He was a responsible drinker. But the time came when my father heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. He accepted him as his personal Lord and Savior. He loved the Lord and served the Lord with all his heart. The Spirit of God came into my father, regenerated his spirit, and he was filled with the Spirit of God, washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. He became a new creature in Christ. All the alcohol and cigarette disappeared. 180 degree turn. His life was completely changed. My father lived a God-fearing life for the rest of his days. The very last day, before my father went to be with the Lord, he asked me, when would you be returning to New York? His voice was very faint. And he said, when you're going back? And I didn't know how to answer him, because I was scheduled to go last night. And I didn't know how to answer him. And before I answered, he said to me, don't worry about your ticket. I'll pay to change your ticket. And I knew where he was coming from. He did not want me to leave. He did not want me to go back to New York. I can go on and on with memories, but time won't permit me. My father lived a good life. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that the Lord will say to him, well done, you good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord. I so look forward to that day. Thank God for that blessed hope. Thank God that he made a way for us. Death, where is your sting? Where is it? There is none. Because Jesus Christ came and made a way. So that we have that blessed hope that I would see my Father one day in glory. I look forward to that day when the trumpet will sound and the dead in Christ will rise first. I was so planning on both of us going up in the rapture together. I was planning on that. But we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him to meet him in the clouds, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. I cannot wait on that day. God, give us the grace. I love you, Daddy. And I can't wait to meet you until we meet again. I love you.
After Granddad passed away, I wasn't sure what I would say, but I knew I had to say something. Ivan always said that he wished that we could just play the memories straight from our brain instead of actually talking it out, because there were just so many that we had as children. We spent our entire lives, he spent his entire life with him, and I spent most of it. Granddad has played multiple roles as a grandfather to his grandchildren. He was a driver, a storyteller, a barber, a playground, and sometimes a bank. Ever so often, he would sneak a little money to me and say, "Hey, take this, go buy some sweet drink." Eventually, that turned into, "Hey, go buy some coffee," because I stopped drinking soft drink. I remember he would pick me up from Donruss, and I would sit on the front seat with him until the end of the day when he dropped all the other kids home. By that time, I would finish my homework. When I was a little child, I used to sit on his lap. The three moles he had on his face never got a break from me. I used to pull it, until one day I thought it was going to come off. It was the most entertaining thing, and if you know me, it doesn't take much. Those are only a few early memories. I haven't been home in 4 years, and I was hoping they did not come that I would not see him. It always crossed my mind, so I'm grateful that I was able to be home for the past couple of months to spend this time with him. The last few days seeing him was not easy, but I wouldn't have wanted to spend it anywhere else and with anyone else. That's it. Granddad, we love you, and we'll miss you tremendously. The house will never be the same without you, but we know you are the Lord, and one day we'll meet again.
Just one last thing, and it's all common in all what we have said. Daddy left us with a legacy, and we would all agree that that legacy is his teachings, and most of all, take care of your family. Do not let anything be undone.
Thank you. Left us.
A good father leaves an inheritance to his children's children. And if we listened carefully to all that was rehearsed, you would hear that singular thing running through the entire discourse, the legacy of the man. In a time when we hear people talking about bad parenting, and we hear people talking about dysfunction in the world, we have an understanding that there are people, there are men who take care of their family and who set an example of legacy. We thank you for your rehearsal of the life and times of our brother Chatarpaul Ganness. And I think everybody in here would agree that truth was spoken. And if anybody say anything different, I would say to them, about. I'd like to introduce our pastor, Reverend Ulan Banfield, who has been teaching and molding and growing a congregation in this inner city to serve the Lord and to be a beacon of light in this area. He has been the pastor of the entire family for quite some time. Sir, it's my privilege to introduce you to Minister now.
Thank you, Brother Aaron, and a good morning to all. I sat there, I looked, I listened, and I could only come to one conclusion. What a man, and what a family. Seeing that this is a celebration of him passing on from one life to another, I think we should all applaud that family. Let's put our hands together. It has been said before, and I'll say it again, because this has been a very, very, or rather it is, a very, very precious family to Holiness Revival Ministries. So although it has been said at the beginning, let me extend my condolences to you, Dolly, especially because I know, having been married for 64 years, life is never going to be the same for you again. And to the rest of the family members and relatives, our condolences from Holiness Revival Ministries, or the members, to you all. The next few months are going to be emotionally hard years for you, Dolly. Emotionally hard years. No matter how strong you may be, separation is always a trying time, much more so when you have lived with someone for 64 years. The book of Ecclesiastes 3:1 tells us, to everything there is a season and a time, to every purpose under the sun. God, the creator of heaven and earth, the one, the true, the living God, has made it so. The first two times identified were a time to be born and a time to die. Chatarpaul, having been born on the 13th of February 1929 and departing on the 14th of March 2023, he completed his full cycle, extended beyond the 70 allotted by God, for which we must be thankful to God for. Even though death is inevitable, and it has been around with us from the genesis of time, we still can't get used to it. Especially when it reaches home, there's always a degree of sorrow. There's a degree of emotional pain, and to some even grief at times. But there are a few chunks in the Bible that tells us about life after death. There are some people who don't believe that there is such a life. The atheist thinks that when you're dead, that's it, it's all over. Other believe that when you die, you go and you stay in a hole until. And then there is the truth that we can find in God's Word, the Holy Bible, God's Word to man. I seem to have got my notes mixed up here, so just let me find where it should begin. So, in the Bible, there were accounts of persons who left this earth. And the Bible will tell us where they went. This will tell us that there is definitely life after death. The first one I want to think about is a man called Enoch. The Bible tells us in Genesis that Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. So here was a man, just like you and I, a living being, and then he didn't even die. He just was not. He disappeared. Where could he have gone? When we read that he walked with God, it tells us that his life was lived to please God at a time when the whole world was in sin. So God saw this man who purposed in his heart that in spite of all that was going on around him, all the wrong that was going on around him,
He chose to live a life that would be pleasing to God. God recognized this, as he still recognizes that today, and God just took him where? Evidently, it has to be where God is. Then there's another man in the Bible called David, King David, king of all Israel. We read about him in the book of Samuel, where he had a son who died as a baby. The Bible tells us that David grieved for the death of his son. So much so that he stopped eating completely. He fasted. And every day, every night, he would be on his face crying out to God for the healing of his son. The Bible tells us that the son eventually died. And David just got up, washed his face, cleaned up himself, and went into his palace and had a sumptuous meal. Now, if that account had finished it there, it could be said of David that he was callous, because as soon as the boy died, that's when he started to eat. But the Bible doesn't stop there. The account doesn't stop there. When they question him about his behavior at the time, he said, "Why should I not eat? He can't come to me, but I can go to him." Go to him where? Evidently, there is life after death. So that's Old Testament. Let's look at the New Testament. When Jesus came to live here upon the earth, there's a man called Paul, greatest apostle that ever lived. He had an experience with God such as no other apostle had had. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians that he was caught up to the third heavens. Now, this is not the atmospheric heaven or the celestial heaven. This is way beyond. He called it the place called paradise. He saw the place. And God gave him revelation, such as no man had ever received, about a number of things concerning earth and life. And among that revelation was the question of death. You see, we want to understand, we serve a living God, a God who created the heavens and the earth, a God who had put man here upon the earth for a divine purpose. Man moved away from God because of sin, but God never gave up on man, never did. So he gave people experiences so that they can write. And this is how we have the Bible. It is inspired by God, but written by men. Men wrote as God inspired. So the Bible is the only word of God to man. And it tells us everything that God wants us to know concerning life, death, and the hereafter. Only God could know those things. Man can't know it.
But God did not leave us in ignorance. So, He appoints people to do things, to know things, and He gives them the experiences as to how they can know. And Paul was such a man, caught up into the third heavens, paradise, and given revelation. And listen to what this great man Paul wrote. 2 Corinthians 5. He says, "For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle," meaning our bodies, "were dissolved," such as Chatarpaul's now, that's referring to the tabernacle, our bodies, he said, "We know." Now listen to these words. "We know." How can he know? Because it was revealed to him by God for the purposes of us getting an understanding of what transpires after death. He says, "We know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we know that we have an house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens." He's speaking now of a celestial body. And having received the first-hand revelation from the Lord, he was able to say in verse 6 of 2 Corinthians 5, "Therefore, we are always confident." Note the words. "Therefore, we are always confident." Having said, "We know," he's now saying, "We are confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in this body, we are absent from the Lord." "We are confident," he says again, "I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord." A man who had divine revelation from God, who showed him things, such as he did with John and Paul on the Isle of Patmos, showed up end time things. But Paul knew, and he was so confident that he was ready to go on to be with the Lord. He said it. He said, "I'd rather go. But if I go, how can I accomplish what God sent me here to do?" So he says, "I'll stay with you." And when the time came, we heard it from Anella, when the time came for his departure, he didn't fret about it. He knew he was going to be beheaded. Oh, what a death. He knew he was going to be beheaded. For what crime? For telling people about Jesus Christ, the only way that you can get to the Father. He was beheaded. But just before that, what did he say? "I ran the race. I ran the race. I fought a good fight. I'm finished the course. Now there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness." Paul knew where he was going, and he went there. So confident was he. And then we have it from the mouth of Jesus himself. Who is this Jesus? Jesus Christ is God's Son here upon earth, born of a Virgin Mary, so that he can come to redeem man back to God. That was his earthly position as a man here upon earth, born of a woman. But that's not the beginning of Jesus. Jesus has been with the Father from the very beginning. When was the beginning? Absolute.
always was. Never had a beginning, never will have an ending. From eternity to eternity, Jesus Christ is God, come in the flesh to redeem man back to God. Why redeem man? Because man have sinned and have been separated from God. So there were some people in Jesus' time called the Sadducees. And I think their title was very, very well put to them. You see, they were sad, you see, because they didn't believe in the resurrection. They felt like the atheists do today, that when you die, that's it, over. And they had a trick question. They always wanted to trick Jesus. They had a trick question to Jesus. They gave a story about a woman who was married and her husband died. And they referred to the Mosaic law that says, if you're married to a man and he dies, his brother has to take his place. So she had to be married to the brother. And the trick question was, this woman was married to seven brothers. Now that tells a lot about the woman herself, eh? Because if all of them die. So they asked Jesus, in the resurrection, because they're contesting the resurrection of Jesus, in the resurrection, whose husband would she have? Listen to the words of Jesus in red writing in the Bible, indicating that it is Jesus who spoke these very words that have been documented. In John 14, verses 1 to 3, Jesus answered the Sadducees. He says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Oh, that's not what he said here. That's another time. I have this whole thing mixed up. I don't know why. Let me see if I can find it. I hate when these things happen, but this is because of hurrying to do something. Okay, it's not even here. But I happen to know my word. So they asked Jesus, who's wife would she be? Jesus says, you do not knowing the scriptures, inferring that if you know the scriptures, you would know exactly what is to be. He went on to say, for in heaven it is not given that people would be married anymore. They would be like the angels in heaven. And in specific answer to the question posed by him, he says, have you not read, I am the God of Abraham, I am the God of Isaac, I am the God of Jacob. I am not the God of the dead, but of the living. And if we know our Bibles, we would know that Abraham, Isaac and Jacob are very much alive, so that what God is saying is, when you leave here, there's life after death. I am. Present tense. I am the God of Abraham. I am the God of Jacob. I am the God of Isaac. I am not the God of the dead. I am the God of the living. And later on, I wouldn't call it a demonstration, it just happened to be so, but later on a mountain that is called the Mount of Transfiguration in the Bible, Peter, James, and John, his disciples, were with Jesus on that mountain, and Jesus transfigured himself. He put on his glorified body. And right there, standing with him, was who? Moses and Elijah. Dead thousands of years before. So loved ones, there is life after death. And hear what Jesus says in John 14, 1-3. He says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. What more proof can we want than this? It is only the fool that will say in his heart that there is no God who would not believe the written word of God. The Bible, God's word, to mankind also tells us in Hebrews 9:27 that it is appointed unto men once to die, and after that, judgment. So, if death is the end of it all, what judgment are we talking about? And if there's a judge, because there can't be a judgment without a judge, if there is a judge, who is he judging? Now, quite a lot has been said about Chatarpaul. And I know, as his pastor, what he did to enable his relatives, family, to say beyond any reason of doubt that he is in heaven with the Lord. And let me just interject here that at times like this, funeral services, we always hear about everybody going to heaven. Not so. The person who has prepared a place for us has always also told us how we are going to get there. And if we don't facilitate the how, we're not going. So it's not a question, sad to say, oh, I wish everybody would end up in heaven. But sad to say, it is not so. So there's going to be a judge, and there's going to be a judgment. We see then that death is not as final as some may think. If there's going to be a judgment, it follows there's going to be a judge to the departed soul that we have got to face. And this is a very sobering fact that each and every one of us, let's not just come to a funeral. Let's hear the word of God. I too could say like everyone, yes, we're going to heaven. But I know different to that. And I want you to know that it is not so. We are all going to face a judge. It's a serious, sobering fact. It's not a question of whether we believe it or not. To disbelieve something doesn't change it from truth. Our disbelief doesn't change truth from being truth. The persons that say there is no God doesn't change God from being God. One day they will find out.
So is entrance into heaven an automatic thing? Is it because we are born into a particular religion? Is it because we go to a particular church, this one included? What makes us able to get there, candidates for heaven? Entrance into God's heaven is conditional, and it is Jesus. Jesus. Only Jesus. No one else but Jesus. Why? For two reasons. He said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Song's dogmatic, eh? Well, he has every reason to be dogmatic. You see, because he came from glory, came to earth to lay his very life down, to be crucified by his own creation. For what purpose? So that innocent blood, holy blood, sinless blood could be shed to atone for man's sin. Now, if that blood has been shed by Jesus Christ to bring man back to God, because the Bible tells us that in Corinthians, God was in Christ Jesus reconciling men back to God. If Jesus paid the price for our salvation, does that mean that we all have got that salvation? No. He paid the price, and something has to be done in order to get what he has paid for. The Bible puts it this way. God, Jesus Christ is God's gift of eternal life. Life after death in heaven with him, eternal life. Eternal damnation is the opposite. You don't have Jesus, it's hell. Some people don't like that word, but Jesus spoke about it. So if Jesus Christ is God's gift of eternal life, and I know that lots of you here have already received that gift, but all that we have said about Chatarpaul, he didn't hear one single thing. It's about those of us who are here who wanted to hear about him. So what I'm saying is, for those of you who have not yet come into that place where Chatarpaul has been, where I was some time ago as a sinner, haven't come into that place. How do you get there? For God so loved you, John 3:16. For God so loves you. He loves you. He gave his only begotten Son to die for you. That if you would only receive him, he gives you eternal life. So as God's gift to mankind, the gift has to be received. And that's where we are messed up, completely messed up on the face of this earth by man-made religion, because every religion have their way, but none of the religions can show where their way went, was killed, buried, and rose from the dead. Only Jesus. Yesterday after this service, a young man came to me and was talking about another form. There's no other way. Jesus Christ is the way. And to have that place with him in heaven, the Bible tells us except you are born again, you cannot enter into the kingdom of God. You cannot. What is it to be born again? To come to this church? No, no, no. To be born again is to recognize your sinful condition. Recognize that you can't save yourself and commit your life to the one who is able to save you, and that's Jesus Christ. 41 years ago, if I had died, I'd go straight to hell. Why? Because I was born in sin, I was shaped in iniquity, and I went full strength in carrying out how I was born. Until I heard about Jesus Christ and his love for me. And on the 31st of January 1982, 41 years ago, I made that commitment of my life to him. And like Chatarpaul, and like many others, life changed completely. How so? I was born of the Spirit of God. How can you be? If thou shalt confess with your mouth, the Bible said, and really believe in your heart, not an assent of your mind, a conviction of your heart, you shall be saved. Saved from what? Eternal damnation. So that's our purpose here, and like other churches around the world who are gospel churches, that's our purpose. To lead the people to the Lord Jesus Christ. And you are here this morning. Yes, it's nice of you to attend Chatarpaul's funeral, but I will not. And I'll say it again, I will not ever not use this as an opportunity. If one person who attends the funeral and doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Savior, if that one person could make a commitment of their life to the Lord, it will not be in vain, all that I have said. Chatarpaul made a commitment of his life to Jesus. So that most of the family and some of the relatives have not. I know that. I don't know about those of you who are in the congregation. I know some of you, yes, definitely, you are members of this church. I know you have given your life. But our responsibility is to make sure that nobody passes through this door without hearing the truth of the only way of obtaining a life with Christ after death. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you that opportunity. You are under no obligation. It all depends on what you want. To live forever with Christ Jesus in heaven, or to be eternally separated from him. And there's only one other place. You see, this body will die. But there is something in us, the soul and the spirit of man, that can never die. Because we were created from the very beginning in the image and likeness of God, and God can't die. So where is our soul going to go with our spirit? If not in heaven, to hell. Will God send the people to hell? Not the God I serve. He sends nobody to hell. But if you have chosen to go, feel free. The choice is always ours. There or there. And there's only one way to get there, and that is a life in Christ Jesus. I'm going to help you with a simple prayer. The prayer can't save you. Many people have said this prayer, but they're not saved because there's no commitment of their heart. And if there is a commitment, there's going to be a change of life. Not all at once, but there's going to be a change of life. Because when the Spirit of God comes into you, you are translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God, and things change when we are in that kingdom. So would you bow your heads, those of you who will make that commitment of your life to the Lord Jesus Christ? I want to harp on the word commitment. That's the word I got saved under. Commitment. Simply means that this is not going to be the end of it. There's going to be a follow through, a pursuing. That's the kind of commitment that saves us. Would you pray this prayer meaningfully from your heart? Dear God in heaven, I come to you, a sinner, for your word says, all have sinned and come short of your glory. As a sinner, I believe with all my heart that Jesus Christ left heaven's glory, came to earth, and died for me. I believe with all my heart that you, Jesus, rose from the dead. And I now accept you, Jesus, as my Savior. I confess you, Jesus, as my Lord. Lord Jesus, forgive me of all my sins. Come into my heart. Put your Spirit in me. And teach me to live for you. By faith, I receive you into my heart, Lord Jesus. And I thank you for saving me. Amen. Okay, if you have made that commitment, you are going to experience some very definite changes in your life. What you need to do is to go find a church. You don't have to come here. There's only one church, the Church of Jesus Christ. It's international. Find a church where they preach the Word of God. Not religion. The Word of God. Become a part of that church and begin to listen to the Word of God and let the Word of God change your life, because the Spirit of God in you is now going to work with the Word of God to bring about life change. So God bless you richly. Thank you so kindly for being so patient and so attentive. Thank you very much. I hand you over to the Master Chaplain.
Thank you, Pastor. Would we stand and sing this song, No Longer Asleep?
It's a melody. You surround me with song. I deliver it from my enemies till all my fears have come.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. chosen me. Lord has called my name. I'm born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave.
It's important that we support each other. Together is one of the words that you find in our statement as a country. Together
we aspire. Together we achieve. It's important that we support each other. We know that Sister Dolly will have times of pain and ache and longing and hurt, but she serves a God of comfort. I ask you to stretch your hands towards the family as we pray. Father, you placed us in families because you knew the necessity for us to be able to lean on each other in times of need. This is a time of need, Lord. When this family needs support, when this family needs comfort, when this family needs to be told, I'm here for you. You are the God of comfort. So with your direction, Lord, we ask that all of us would be able to give them support. But you, Lord, are the best supporter they will ever have. We want them to know that they can call on you in any time, at any occasion, and you would respond to them. We want them to know, Lord, that you would not leave them without comfort. The fact that you have accepted our brother in your arms does not mean, Lord, that they are going to be left without comfort. Pastor talked about Enoch to them this morning, Lord, and we know that when Enoch was taken, his son lived the longest that ever could be lived because you showed that you can take care of us. So take care of this family, Lord. Take care of them. Bless them. Comfort them. In Jesus' name. Amen. I'll introduce Pastor to close the service. Do the committal.
God said, and so shall it be. From dust we were taken, and unto dust we will return. Dust to dust, ashes to ashes. Lord Jesus, we commit this body to the flames, knowing that it is only a body that life has been extinguished from, but happily knowing that that life lives on forever and ever to be with you. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I don't know, are we having a viewing? You having a viewing? Outside? Oh, up there. Oh, yeah, right there. You don't have viewing here? Okay, you can open up the coffee and view it here.
Supermarket flowers from the windowsill. I threw the day-old tea from the cup. Pack out the photo album Mama had made. Memories of a life that's been loved. Took the cat wells, stone cards, and soft animals. Put the old ginger beer down the sink. Friends always told me, don't you cry when you're down, but there's a tear every time that I blink. Oh, I'm in pieces, it's tearing me up, but I know a heart that's broke is a heart that's been loved. So I sing hallelujah. Night suits neatly in a case. Mom says she'd drive and put her hand on my cheek, wipe a tear from the side of my face. I hope that I see the world that she did, cause I know a life with love is a life that's been lived. So I sing hallelujah. Shape of my dad. When I fell down, you'll be there holding me up. Stretch your wings as you go, and when God takes you back, he said, hallelujah, you're home. Ooh.